What's going on, man?
How are you?
We're just going
to
close this.
Good to see you.
For half a second, I saw his shaved head. I thought it was you. I was just like, oh, Sam.
Yeah, it'll come eventually.
Golden mic, so you know this is going to be special.
I like this. You know, I actually like this setup, man. I like the little windscreen in front. And you're right. And Sam pointed out yesterday, I liked it because they're gold.
Yeah, Jim thinks that the mics are better than the ones we have at home.
They are.
Because these are gold.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
You feel like Rihanna. Like you're going to be singing a little hit here. Let me shut my phone off and try to be a pro.
Yeah. Jim just got a new mic back in New York, though. Jim's now in the club of people who has his own microphone. Yeah.
I read about it in the trades.
It gets plugged.
It was all over Variety Magazine. Jim Norton gets his own microphone in SiriusXM. Congratulations.
Thank you, bro.
That's a milestone. That's a milestone in radio.
Well, they told me it's because they know I like my own mic, but then I'm like, oh, no, I think it's because no one else wants to talk into the one I've been using. I think I'm the problem.
You think that's what it was, too many complaints from other people?
Yeah, they're like, we don't trust him.
Did you add any custom little design stuff to it? Maybe a little silhouette of your face on the side?
No, just a little ridge and something hanging off it.
That's good for your brand. That's what they say out here a lot. That's good for your brand.
Just makes it easier for him to grip. It helps Jim come to work. He's motivated now to talk into it.
Of course he is.
And I took your advice. I went overseas. I've been crediting you with whoever would ask. I want to do other ones, but I did Australia.
Yeah.
All Burr, because I just kept hearing you say, dude, just go. And I'm like, why am I not going? You're right.
How much fun was that?
It was fun, man.
Yeah, that jet lag's a bitch, though. That's probably the worst one. That's the worst one you're going to run into. Everything else, especially if New York, if you're going over to like England or something, I mean, I think that's only like a 4 or 5 hour difference. That's not that bad.
It's not bad.
Yeah, you know,
Australia's
from LA
terrible,
to Australia
right?
is like, that's a 14 hour or something crazy, 16 hour difference.
It was 14 hours. They're 14 hours ahead of us.
It's 17 hours ahead.
Hi, Dan.
Dan Harmon's coming.
Dan Harmon is here as well. Hi, buddy.
All right, Dan Harmon, how are you?
What's going on?
Let's pull your mic up. Do you guys know each other?
I don't think we've ever met. Hello, Dan.
Hello.
How are you, sir?
How are you? Nice to meet you.
Dan Harmon, Bill Burr, Jim Norton, Sam Roberts, welcome to the show.
Oh, you're Bill Burr. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
I saw your name on the signage sheet. You're fancy.
Yeah. I have to sign in like everybody else. I am a fancy person.
Well, welcome to the show, man. How's it going?
It's going good. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
What do you got going on?
Well, I'm showing up late for this, so. It's just a lot of stuff. I don't know. I'm collaborating with a lot of people in the new TV world, which is just streaming. So that's just boring to describe, but it's just getting together with a lot of people and trying to launch a lot of stuff because
just like specific like shows.
Yeah,
like people are just coming to you for ideas now.
Yeah, I have a little studio in Burbank that focuses on animation. We did the Charlie Kaufman movie Anomalisa that got nominated for an Oscar, but we're looking to do stuff that's maybe less smart and more profitable. Who knows?
Yeah.
Yeah, just a lot of young writers coming in, anybody with an idea. And then I try to help them, like, break stories, come up with a good pitch, go out there, find somebody to pay for it, and that's so that they can get paid to write something and so on. We're doing something with Louis C.K. and Albert Brooks. I'm not sure what I'm allowed to announce in that area, but I know we originally did that for FX. And now
can you tell us the entire plot?
I can actually, because it's not about much. They're cops, and it's just like I think it's comes from Louis's idea of like, oh, who has the worst job in the world right now, and it kind of personalizes and dimensionalizes these cops. It's sort of like Car 54, Where Are You? Not that anybody listening is like, oh, they're instant clarity. but they may be familiar with the concept of that show, which is just like a workplace comedy with two cops that
sure.
are just like regular guys.
And F is for Family got picked up for a second season, which
yep.
is awesome. Which is
That's
when
amazing.
Is that?
We're finishing that up right now. It comes out in spring of 2017.
Do you like seeing yourself animated?
Well, it's not me. It's you can tell Jim hasn't watched it.
He hasn't seen it.
No.
Breaks my heart that a friend of mine.
No. I know who it is. I'm saying your voice is it. Do you like seeing
it
coming out of
an animation? Yet another thing to get over.
You do.
I just did a taped another special, and that's the worst fucking thing I do every 2 years is sit down and have to look at that, because with that thing there's breaks. You do F is for Family, then you know other actors are talking, so I just have to get through a couple scenes and then eventually get used to it. I don't have to look at myself, it's just my voice. It's a lot easier. But then when you do the stand-up specials, when you guys sit there and edit,
where'd you tape
the Ryman in Nashville?
Oh,
was awesome. Yeah, so I like doing it.
But you don't like watching back any of your old stand-up specials?
I don't like watching any of them.
Even when they're like, this is my brand
new.
Have
to. They have to, but yeah. you have to, so it's what you want. But if there was a way to just be like, you know, just do it, and they know what I want, and
right.
I never look at it, that's perfect.
You watch just to edit? Like, you got to watch yourself, because I don't want anybody making editing decisions, but as soon as you're done, it's like, never again will I watch this. Ever.
Yeah.
But what?
No, but you know what's weird? If I just tape myself at a club and I just go home to see, like, I guess, to just to watch, if I'm just going to see it,
right.
I can sit there and watch it
sure.
and just be like, all right, I need to do this or do that. But, like, when knowing that you're editing this thing and then everybody could potentially see it, like, oh, my God, why did I do that with my hand? Look how big my fucking ears are. It was just this terrible.
Yeah, I throw a douchey smile. Yeah. I'm like, oh, you fucking worm.
Look how self-conscious you are right there. Yeah, it's just awful. It's just, the whole thing is just awful. So
I get so drunk during the podcast that I do, and it's not written, so I always, like, Wednesday it comes out, so I always listen to it because I never remember. It's kind
wow.
of it's kind of the audio equivalent of what's that called? The stranger, the where you sleep on your hand and then whatever. I have no idea what I said, and then sometimes I'm like, oh, wait, was that a really good show and or a really bad show? And I whatever my theory is.
Do you get like
wrong.
Blackout drunk and do a podcast?
I mean, I guess that sounds awful. It sounds like a movie of the week, but it's yeah. I mean, it's. You know, blackout drunk is when you, like, wake up with an injury. I think this is just my...
Well, I think blackouts, you don't remember what you did or something.
Right, yeah. You're okay. Blackout.
Yeah, you're taking it to the Evel Knievel level.
Right.
Where you wake up with a collarbone sticking out of your chest. You can just not remember what you said and get dirty looks. At, you go, right. Wow, I guess I was that guy.
Yeah, I mean, I remember that I was on stage. I remember that I was in front of a microphone. And I can maybe remember, like, yeah. topics that came up. But
you're like a guy with, like... theoretically sensitive information, like you were just talking about a project that you're like, I don't know if we should be talking about this, and you have to work with
right.
celebrities that might not want their business out there.
Yeah, yeah.
You should probably be responsible, right, for what you say on a podcast?
Nah, nothing will ever happen.
No, it's the internet. It doesn't count.
Right.
You can libel people, slander, I mean, it's the internet. That's the internet.
Yeah,
you can just take shit that isn't yours,
just play their voicemails,
to your
yeah.
curated all, as they say.
Have you have you said things on the podcast? You're like, oh fuck, why did I say that?
Yeah, well, I did the Chevy Chase thing. I got out my phone.
Oh,
this
that's
is
right.
This is before. That's before, by the way, it was a podcast. That's actually kind of the reason it is a podcast now, is because what that was a show that I was doing in the back of this comic book store, where I don't know if you guys have done stand up there, the Meltdown, but it was just like a cabaret kind of audience. It was just like, oh, there's 150 people here, and I was like well comfortable by that time of sharing my frustrations of working with a living legend. Like I had done it so many times that I wasn't associating it with danger, you know, like I didn't. Now I look back on it and I'm like, why did you pick up that firecracker? And like, but if you pull out from that footage, it's like I was just eating firecrackers all the time. It's just like that one happened to go TMZ. But what I did was it wasn't for the internet. It was just for this room full of people. I took out my phone and I had this voicemail from him that was particularly vitriolic. And I was like, and played it into the microphone. Somebody in the audience recorded that. They put it on the internet. And then it was like, oh man, that was a huge mistake. Like, I had to.
When that story broke, though, wasn't everybody saying that it was like a community rap party or something like that? That they never put it into the context of.
That's what Chevy was talking about. That's why we were quote unquote feuding. By the time the story broke, we were already friends again. We were laughing about it, but it was like what had happened is at the rap party after a season that was very contentious. I thought I was being like a white knight to the crew at the rap party and saying, okay, before we play the gag reel and I'll go home, like, I'm your boss. You can't get fired. So everybody on the count of three, just say, go ahead and say, fuck you, Chevy. And everybody very much participated.
Dude, there could literally be a series of just Chevy Chase stories, just animating them and then cutting to live action. I mean, the guy is a fucking legend.
Yeah.
He's a legend. The stories of this guy.
So he was like, he left when I did that. And there was this whole thing about, oh, in front of my wife and kids. Well, his kids are 48. Like, I but like he
like middle-aged children.
How do I explain to my children?
He's got a colostomy bag. How could you do that in front of my child?
Exactly. You think 48 years in, they're confused as to whether or not their dad is an asshole?
Yeah, exactly. Well, that was my defense. I was like, they know him. Right. Like they've had to work with him longer than anybody. I hope it's clear. I know I was in the wrong and I shouldn't have done that, but at the rap party or otherwise. But what?
Him and the family just walked out when you did that?
Yeah, he just left. I mean, rap parties aren't that fun anyway. But
he was there when you said "fuck you, Chevy."
Yeah.
Oh, so you kind of just breaking his balls in front of everybody?
Yeah, like, because
you can't say you didn't know what was going to happen. Were you drunk?
What do you mean? I'm sure I was. It was after 3.
Okay, now it all makes sense.
But it was supposed to be like about blue collar camaraderie. It was like, oh, here's this guy that's been controlling our lives for a season, who like is sometimes responsible for some really uncomfortable moments. Like I'm gonna do you the favor of letting you say this out loud. So it's like kind of a lynch mob. Like no one will be. It's a firing squad. Like no one's
and
accountable.
He obviously had no sense of humor about it.
Yeah, I think he was I mean, he has a great sense of humor. He's not a thin skinned guy at all. Mm-hmm. But he's also, I was being a dick to him, so he was like offended
by
that.
Was he shocked that people saw him that way? Sometimes people don't see themselves that way, and then all of a sudden when the whole crew goes, fuck you, you're like, wow, am I interpreted that way by them?
I don't know. I can't get inside
Which makes that person even more hateable. It's like, at least we thought you knew.
No self-awareness.
Like, it's like, how you fucking treated me that way and you had no idea that would annoy me? Like, people when they do...
The lack of self-awareness makes
you
them hateable.
You know what people
like that
do? They do a lot of double hands to the chest. Like, I wasn't that fucking thing. You're just like, fuck you.
Yes. I think he always...
the worst. Like, that was like when that publicist backed over those 16 people. Do you remember that? And
you
got away with it on Long Island?
Gruber, I think, or...
Yeah.
And
the picture of her in the post, she had both hands like to her chest, like, you know. I didn't see that entire mob of people.
It's weird his relationship with other people that he's working with versus his relationship with the public. Like, I've never seen a bigger man of the people, like on the Paramount lot. Like, he would, anytime there was a tour, you'd walk around the corner and he'd just be holding court telling people stories about Fletch and stuff, and everyone is like freaking out. I saw him, like, there was a guy doing, like, we had a hot dog vendor outside the stage once, and he starts going, oh, holy crap, Chevy Chase, I can't fucking believe my sister's going to freak out. He's like, where's your sister? And he gets out his phone, and Chevy Chase grabs the guy's phone after he dials his sister's number, walks off for 20 minutes and is like bullshitting with his sister. The guy is like freaking out. I mean, so it was. It's weird, like how heroic and noble he was, like to what
he's
he saw
have a
as
balance.
The consumer. Yeah. But I think he saw everybody. That was a weird speech impediment. I think he saw everybody that he kind of shared a camera with. He's a soloist, and he's kind of playfully competitive, and like kind of like sees it as a competition. Like he never saw it as a team event.
Maybe said that SNL background. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
So. I'm surprised, though, that after like that all breaks, that you decide, I got to start doing a podcast. Because a lot of people would be like, let me retreat and do less publicly because I don't like all this backlash.
I got to do a podcast, right. Borderline blackout drunk.
Well, right. Yeah, exactly.
Right. This is the next move.
Yeah. Well, talking into a microphone like feels so much better than not doing it when you have stuff bouncing around in your head. I'm sure you guys have the same condition. You know, it feels therapeutic because otherwise you there's no... words for it, and so to have that...
I just berate the person I live with.
Yeah. Okay. So it's more like a Red Fox routine or something, and just like there's to have that like explode, and then to have that be the reason I wouldn't have that outlet anymore. That wasn't an option for me. So the opposite was, well, then if this is going to be on TMZ because it's leaked, you know, then I'll just leak everything, you know, just listen to me talk every week for 2 hours and then it won't be newsworthy anymore. But
there's just so much stuff. Yeah. Like, he's always talking shit.
Yeah.
Like, are you gonna report on it?
Yeah, it won't feel clickable. It won't feel like naughty if the guy is like always running his mouth. Then it's like, yeah.
Still also depends on what you talk about, though. Because there are ones that no matter what, like when Stern made that comment about that actress or whatever, going like, yeah, you're going to get all this work. He's like, you're not. You need to lose all this weight, right, and blah, 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 which was true.
Right.
Health, as far as health goes and that type of thing and the way Hollywood looks at people, and it was totally true. But because that was such a big thing, out of all this shit that guy says, Don't you remember that? That was, you know, that was like a, you know, it was a typical 3 days everybody gives a shit, and then 3 days later, you know,
they don't care.
They moved on.
Yeah,
they moved on, Jim. They moved on to you and onto your microphone.
Yeah.
Has Jim gone Hollywood?
The hot news in Hollywood.
Yeah. Demanding his own microphone.
Yeah, it's pretty you can't predict at all. Like, you could say 48, like, totally, like, horrible inflammatory things and get all used to it, and then it's like this weird weather phenomenon. It's like a tornado or an earthquake in terms of, like, what becomes
soccer
this.
Moms is my
theory. That's like
40
the
soccer
monkey.
Moms all tweet at the same time. It gains enough hashtag traction, right. And then it's such an easy story, right? You're not going to talk about the Great Barrier Reef being dead when you can talk about, oh, can you believe this guy said that about someone on a podcast? And it just becomes like
Yeah, my rule became you guys don't have this luxury. You have to like have discipline and like do jokes, and those are gonna involve the rest of the world. But my rule became, because I'm babbling, I had to go, okay, it's at the end of my nose where all the, you know, I can confess, I can talk about anything. No one's, it's not gonna be clickbait if I talk about sticking stuff up my butt when I'm jerking off, or like you know.
What do you stick in your butt when you jerk off?
I've
you can't brush over that. Yeah, bad
scripts. He didn't like
people's dreams. People's dreams. I'm really fancy. I'm like a Sam Shepard play.
You take those little brass clips out of there before you do it, or is that an added Christmas bonus for you?
People's dreams.
Yeah.
A Sharpie pen, Jim Norton. A Sharpie pen. Like,
have you really?
Yeah, I tried it because I read a Playboy article about the prostate getting stimulated and stuff, and so I tried a Sharpie pen. But and then
you put
I,
some hand sanitizer on it or something first, or just find a pen and put
it
up there.
That pen is the thing that got dirty, not me.
Cap on or cap off?
It was the end. That's why I picked it, because I was like
an octopus
just
afterwards.
Where'd it go? Squirting ink.
The cap is designed to be like a grappling hook. You wouldn't want to actually put that up there. Like,
just hooks on to
yeah.
Okay. Hey, you know, you always learn. That's why you got to come up to LA, Jim. You got to learn shit out here.
But,
so did you like it or did you not like it?
Well, it was fine enough. I mean, something in your butt is better than something not in your butt, sure. I guess, is what we find out. But the problem is it worth, like, then you finish orgasming and you're,
you got to go back to Staples.
And now I'm like, now
it's 4:30, there's traffic.
They have to gingerly pull a pen out of your asshole. You're like, that wasn't worth it. That wasn't worth this moment.
I'm just saying he needed more sharps.
Yeah, you know, I was like guys, like, orgasm, like, as soon as it's done, it's like the thought of anything sexual is like mowing the lawn for like at least 20 minutes. But and then during that time, you're like, so that goes off like a light, and then you just have something in your butt. It's like, and
I
it's
just like
the
that,
worst.
That philosophy, though, I've never heard. I guess I've never heard anybody say, well, when you're masturbating, something in your butt is better than nothing in your butt.
Right. If you could magically, like,
I don't know if that's,
yeah, 100%. I think that's a great statement about life, though.
How many times have you gotten caught jerking off? Because it's one thing to just drop your dick, but to have to drop your dick and then pull the thing out of your ass.
Pull out a writing implement.
Yeah. Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Try to play it off.
Your wife catches you, and where's the pen?
Yeah. Right. And the T-square.
No, then you got to play it. You just got to act like you're mad. Can I get a little time by myself, please? Get her out of the fucking room. Shout her out of the room, and then you take it off.
It turns into one of those like gags in the movies with all of it, and you keep pulling out phones and handcuffs and basketballs.
Do you like fingers in your ass? I don't mind a finger once in a while.
I don't like anything in there now, because it's just like, that's the thing, is like, to clarify what I'm saying, if we had telekinesis and we could like make a thing in our butt, like a force of nature in our butt or something that didn't have to then deal with the butt itself, either before or after sex, then maybe we'd always like do something up there to like stimulate those nerve endings. But I don't consider it worth the exchange.
Okay.
Because like so no, I don't.
This is so fucking analytical. It's amazing.
Yeah, I don't do the. I don't involve the butt on either side in my dealings anymore. Okay.
But you know. Try a strap on.
Try a strap, like have somebody peg me, is that what they call it?
Peg. Yeah, peg. Believe me, you don't randomly pull peg out of thin air.
Yeah, exactly. Is that the language? I don't know.
Yeah, that's fucking.
Like a six gauge or a.
Pegging is not one you randomly pull. Yeah. That's not the language of a novice.
I don't know if I would have been able to pull out the word pegging.
Not at all, no. But yeah, I can't really do it. I've dabbled a little bit, but I can't really go through with it because I just.
Well, you're in that scene in Louis's show, like you have the whole monologue when you're talking about your. Are you talking about a dildo that you have, or?
Yeah. I think so. That was I do remember that. That was one of the poker scenes or something. Mm-hmm. I talk about something in my ass. Yeah.
I thought maybe that came from real life that you were just.
I don't remember where that came. I mean, I think that was written specifically for me, but I don't remember where it. What inspired it? If it was something I said on the air.
The last
or...
9 hours of comedy specials you've done.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah.
I was about to say your entire career, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. Why would someone think I like things in my asshole unless they've heard me talk for more than 30
Jim,
seconds?
We want you to stretch out on this one.
Yeah, it was probably his dad.
That's my favorite part of the Louis show, though, is the poker games. Those conversations.
The things
the
he would take for, like the Rick Chrome speech with about the word faggot and how it came to
amazing.
Be.
Yeah.
That came from a conversation. I remember the moment. We were at the Comedy Cellar table, and he was literally just talking about something, and Rick was just having a chat, and Louis wrote that into a script.
That guy, that's out of all the fucking ads they put out, that was the one that hit home, and I was like, I should probably stop saying that, because I had that stupid, like, it doesn't mean that. It means this to me.
Right.
And then once I heard, you know, Rick Chrome, how can you argue with Rick Chrome? You know, yeah. You're just like, all right, Rick. God damn it. You're right. I still say it when I get mad in the car, though.
Sure.
You do?
When somebody, yeah, every once in a while. But then I always think of the Rick Chrome thing, and I'm like, I shouldn't have said that, you know.
Yeah.
It like happens.
Louis changed the world. One person at a time.
That's right.
I used to say.
I thought you were going to start singing a song right there. That would have been perfect.
You think so?
That the Louis changed the world song.
I had this really bad habit from just growing up in the 70s in the Midwest. Like, when I was in the edit bay working on Community as late as 2010, I would say... take that back. Let's see the scene. Ah, that's gay. Get rid of that. Like I was still doing that. There was a sea change during these last like 5 years. Like I found out what it was. I shouldn't be saying that anyway, but I found out the editor was gay and realized I had been nonstop using that word just to mean like
shame,
dumb,
lame,
stupid, retarded,
stinks,
you know?
Yeah.
And then I apologized to him, and then the way he accepted the apology broke my heart, because it was like he was like yeah, that word just reminds me of a lot of stuff, you know. And it was like, oh god, like that really, like,
the thing about gay though, it's like it used to mean happy, and I was really happy, right?
Sure.
And you never heard them complain when it got hijacked, like the really happy people didn't like protesting. Like, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah.
That word used to mean we're really enjoying our day. Well, you guys turned around and took it.
Well, it's almost like the Rainbow Coalition.
Yeah.
Because that was originally Jesse Jackson's group.
Yes.
And then the Rainbow Flag, and then Jesse just kind of backed, like, all right, you can have it.
Yeah, it's not us anymore.
It's all yours, guys.
It's not us.
It's like when the hyenas, too many, move in on the lion, and the lion's like, all right, fuck it, it's yours. Yeah, your zebra.
Enjoy
your
the
zebra.
Meal.
My
so you
pleasure.
Apologized. He accepted your apology?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But
I
it's
mean,
embarrassing because all those times you said it.
Yeah,
finally,
yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, and that's
yeah
what...
but just know that he's done the same thing. That's the thing. It's like he's done something. He said some things and blah, blah, blah.
Sure, that's why,
that's what I say about everybody. Make me feel better about my own shortcomings. I'm sure this person's done something mean to a cat or something.
Right. Do you keep up with the people that were on Community? Because I was thinking this morning when I was driving in, it's amazing how many people have been successful coming off that show. Joel McHale,
God, yes.
It launched.
Jillian.
Yeah, Gillian Jacobs. Donald Glover has now got his own show on FX, which is really good. Have you seen Atlanta, Jim?
I have not.
It's really good. Do you keep
up? Oh, dude, that show's unbelievable.
It's great, isn't it?
The way it's shot, it's like a fucking amazing movie each week.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hung out with Donald a couple times, like, kind of randomly. He came by my office in Burbank, and we bullshitted a little bit. I'll run into people. I have like three friends that I text, and everybody else is just sort of, they're in my phone. Well, like maybe if something weird comes up, like you see something that reminds you of something, and you text him a picture or something, but that's about it.
Was Donald always like the guy who, because hey, I've never seen anybody do as much stuff as he does, you know what I mean? Like, he's got his full-fledged music career.
Yeah.
Then he does stand-up. Atlanta is his. He wrote it, directed it, did the whole deal.
Yeah, people don't understand why would he leave, and it's like, look at his trajectory.
Yeah.
Like he was a writer on 30 Rock as a child, and, like, that guy doesn't know yet if there's something he can't do. You know, like, he should just keep trying everything until he finds out there's something
he can't
do.
When was the last time
a
guy like that came around? The level of stuff that he's done. A guy like that comes around, what, 30, 35 years?
Yeah,
maybe?
I think it's a once-in-a-generation thing, you know? And
he's that guy.
He's a brilliant, brilliant... He's actually a guy who, like, I mean, he's so much funnier. Like, he was an actor, and he was funnier than the stuff that the writers could come up with for him. We started just saying, oh, and then Donald will say something funny here to close a scene, not just a goofy improv we might use later.
You wouldn't even
we
have
don't
to
know
write.
How to blow the scene. We don't know how to blow the cold open. Well, maybe Donald will say something, and sure, he would. And so it's like when you're that funny, it's like... But the weird thing is that also he has like this unique like perspective. Like, he grew up a Jehovah's Witness, and but now he's like he's competing and running with these, like, you know, in this hip hop world where it's like being as hilarious as he is, it's almost like he probably has to like choke up on that bat now.
Yeah, you can't really use that. I mean, you can put it in lyrics maybe, but you can't be like a funny, jovial guy.
Well, a lot of comedy, especially his comedy, it comes from a very, yeah, like very kind of acquiescent, like, or childish. Like,
yeah.
It's like, it's about vulnerability.
I thought Eminem and Biggie were hilarious.
You did.
I mean, Eminem's still alive, but I had to say were because Biggie. I thought they were funny.
Yeah.
Like, they definitely had a lot of humor in
the
stuff.
Yeah, Eminem,
I still think
for sure.
That.
Yeah.
That's as deep as I go.
I mean, Eminem,
yeah, it's like whatever made it onto MTV.
But they also still had to kind of come across as like tough guys.
Yeah, Eminem's,
you know what I mean?
Thing was like, oh, like I'm a crazy white psycho guy from a trailer park. Like, that, it was funny in the sense, it was like Joe Pesci's funny in that you shouldn't say so.
I'll still fucking kill you for real.
Right.
Yeah, but he would pick certain targets, Eminem. He was smart. He didn't pick certain targets that were real hard.
Oh, yeah, he'd pick all like the pop stars.
Yeah, fucking Britney Spears. Well, easy killer.
I don't know, he had some stuff. References to Columbine and shit like that.
No. I mean, as far as other people, he would make fun of, like the rappers he would go after. He wouldn't go after any real hardcore guys. He would make fun of like Britney or Moby or, he would reference tragedy, but not guys that were fucking a problem.
I think he did start kind of attacking Ja Rule a little bit, but Ja Rule, you know?
Yeah.
That was it.
Yeah.
You know, I just realized the Cubs won the World Series and we've been on the
Oh my god, we didn't mention that at all.
We didn't even talk. We were with Ellis the first hour, so we haven't mentioned it the entire show.
I totally forgot. And I actually watched it with my manager, who's a Chicago Cubs fanatic, and he grew up in Chicago. And it was a really fucking...
What did he do when the Indians tied it up with that two-run shot?
I'll play audio, because he didn't know I was taping. I went after they won.
Did you tape it? You didn't tape him when they tied it up, did you?
No, I didn't know they were going to tie it
Chevy
up.
Chevy Chase isn't on this, is he?
it's 10 seconds.
Oh, he was cursing up a blue streak when they tied it.
It's just, you know how it is when you win. Wait.
Yeah!
That's just, and I told Sam, that's what sports are about. It's like, that's the moment. All you, like when the Patriots win, or when your whole year is spent for that one moment.
He's
of
such
victory.
A nice guy, though, Jonathan. He was sitting there, like when the Indians tied the game, because he's like the biggest Cubs fan. He's sitting there going, in the middle of the conversation, "What the fuck? Oh fuck! I'm so sorry. Oh fuck! Yeah. I'm sorry. What the fuck? God damn it! I'm sorry.
It's the World Series. You can curse. No one cares.
He kept turning around.
I just wonder what that dog is thinking. You can hear that little Shih Tzu in the background.
Yeah.
What do dogs think when their owners like start screaming at the top of their lungs?
Dude,
but they're not being.
I just love the two of them, like the way they tortured their fans. I was saying the last thing. It's like, this just makes sense. That the team that's going to lose is going to go up 3-1.
Yeah.
And the team that's going to win is going to go down 3-1. So both people just be like, you know, have this manic and depressive thing and just get totally switched. And then it's like, oh, my God, we're going to do it. And then they're going to have a fucking 2-run homer to tie it. And then there's going to be a rain delay.
Yeah.
It just make you sit there in the anxiety of that for another 20 minutes, just another little twist of the knife before it's finally over, and you put someone out of their misery and you release the other person.
I felt bad for the Indians fans, because I would rather have my team lose fucking 7-2 or 6-2 than tie it up like that.
Exactly. Dude, in 04, when you guys killed us in that game 3, 19-whatever, and people were like, oh my God, how depressed are you? I said, this year actually isn't bad. I like this. 4-game sweep, 2 behind my ear. Just get it over with.
Because
03, the year before, was just like, oh my God, we're going to do it. And then it was Aaron Boone. So I was just like, this is great. There's going to be no Bucky Dent,
just
no Aaron Boone.
Pull the Band-Aid off.
Yeah. But then the fact, you know, that they were able to come back was... It's pretty cool.
Yeah, but it is easier just to get your ass kicked and
way
fucking
better.
Over
way
and you're
better.
Finished than a last minute, because there's so many what-ifs. When you lose 10-3, there's no what-ifs. What if he didn't give up fucking a three-run home run in the fourth and then a two-run shot in the set? There's none of that. But it's when it's that one...
It really is. It's one mistake.
Dude, everyone was questioning Madden with all his pitching things. It's like, dude, he had the walking wounded. They were all tired. And I was just thinking, all they got, they scored all those runs... in the beginning, all they got to do is just hold these guys off, because the later this game goes, the more pitches, it started tipping in the Indians' favor. It was fascinating. Then, of course, the Indians came back and tied it up. It was unbelievable.
I thought he overused the closer, because I was even though the Yankees won so many times, I always criticized Joe Torre. I'm like, he's using Mariano too much at the end of the seventh or the early in the eighth. Leave him for the fucking ninth inning.
Yeah, but they played, this is the thing about that, they played three elimination games in a row.
That's right.
It's like, you got to go with the guy. You got to bring him in, because if he doesn't get you to the next one and he's your best guy, you kind of had to do it.
Yeah.
But that's one of those things. So if then he lets up a home run, then everybody gets to be like, oh, the guy I would have put in who didn't pitch, you know, so there's no footage on him. He would have gone in and he would have saved the fucking day. And it's just like, well, you know, if that was true, then you'd be managing.
That always drove me nuts with Torre, though. I was like, fucking not Mariano. They lost fucking, whatever, Nelson and Stanton.
It's funny, too, because like as soon as the game got tied up or it looked like the Cubs might not win, that's when the Joe Buck hatred really starts to come out on Twitter. Jonathan was hating him because all the Cubs fans hate the way that Joe Buck has called it.
Because he's a St. Louis guy?
Yeah, they say it's clearly he doesn't like the Cubs. That's what they're all, there's a clear bias with Joe Buck.
Did you ever see his, Joe Buck is hilarious. Did you ever see on his Twitter? In case you knew what Twitter was, I held up the phone for you. It says Joe Buck and says something like, I hate your team. Because that's all he gets.
That's so
all
funny.
He gets. Dude, I did Inside the NFL one time, dropping names here. Chris Collinsworth told a funny story about that.
Yeah.
Where people just are always convinced. Like, why do you hate the Bengals so much? You played for them. Why do you hate these guys so much? And he would always be like, no, I don't hate them. I'm just blah, blah, blah. And then finally somebody came up and was like, well, you know, why do you hate the Giants so much? And he just looked at me and says, ah, I just don't like them. Just walked out just to fuck with them.
How was it doing, what was it, Bill Simmons show with Gretzky?
Oh, that was insane. And yeah. He was the nicest guy.
He seemed like a nice guy. He was laughing at all your jokes and everything.
No, and he was asking, I said, you know, I play a little pickup. He goes, oh, you play? He starts asking me, what do you play?
No.
Yeah, like generally interested. Like it was amazing. And I was sitting there for like half, at one point during the interview, it was such a fanboy moment. He was sitting there, he had his hands folded. I was looking at his hands going like, those things held the cup three times. They scored 2,700 points. I'm trying to blow through this before he makes a hand joke.
No, not at all.
And it was just like.
I was trying to connect. What's a peg callback? Callback.
It was amazing. And I couldn't wait to answer the question, what's wrong with hockey? Because that's what I've heard the entire time watching it. It's like the truth is there is nothing wrong with it.
Right.
It's just you just have to accept the fact that you're this rogue sort of sport in this country and you're just all going to be multimillionaires instead of billionaires. But if you go for that brass ring that the NFL is going with, look at it's finally caught up with them how much they tried to mainstream the game.
Yeah.
They've alienated, I think, their main fan base. They got them dressed in pink. They got Katy Perry singing. They're doing games in London. They're on Sunday. They're on Monday. They're on Thursday towards the end of the season. They're on Saturday. And that whole thing where that movie was going, like, they own a day of the week. They've lost that. Like, I forget sometimes.
What day was hockey?
No, I'm saying NFL.
NFL. Oh,
NFL
sorry.
Owns
I
think Sunday.
Okay.
I don't have a lot of charisma. It's easy to drift. I never blame the listener when I'm talking. So they had, like, they own Sunday, that movie, that great line. They own a day of the week.
Yeah.
And they've gotten away from that. It's almost like when you watch like when a Starbucks or something comes up and they have so many locations, they're competing with each other. They kind of did that. And then also the game has also changed so much now where it's just like they were talking about like Tom Brady going like he has 800 yards in the first 2 weeks. And they were writing how that only like 600 of those yards were like for 12 yards and under, just dinking and dunking your way down the field. And I don't know, kind of lost like that, the running back blowing through the line and all that shit.
Right.
I don't know. I was hoping you guys would interrupt me about a minute ago because I ran out of shit to say.
Well, with these sports that come down, like the World Series, it's seven games, but you can get skunked in four games, right? Like,
yeah.
How do you – they must have some kind of mechanism in place to prevent corruption, right? Because, like, can you imagine the money that's at stake if literally your franchise is cut in half? Like all of that advertising,
absolutely.
So how do you keep some pitcher from being in a bar and some guy comes up to him and leaves car keys on the bar next to him and says like, look, there's something parked on the lot for you.
Baseball, they pay him such a disgusting amount of money. Like you'd really have to be a degenerate or just even if you were getting the league minimum. I mean, I think that's still like $750,000 or something like that. I mean, it would take a lot to get to those guys. But the big thing is,
What if the people paying you are the ones saying,
because
the network and Taco Bell need you to shave a pitch? I don't know.
Well, I will say this though: the all throughout the 2000s, I was saying the NBA's fixed, and I was getting all this shit. Because I was also saying baseball was fixed. I had a lot of theories back then. But I was right. I was like Mel Gibson in that movie where he drove the taxi. I was right about the NBA. And what kills me is they did the Oswald thing. They pinned it on one guy. There was one guy. All those fucking games that I watched. I remember when I was at a Utah Jazz game watching them play the Celtics. And I watched them. They're letting them play tonight. Oh, no, they're calling it tight. Oh, no, they're letting them play. And it was just so clearly somebody was fucking with this thing. It's just like, I never saw games like that when I was growing up. Either right out of the gate, it's like an umpire. They establish the strike zone. You see the first at batters, just turn about, guys at bat looking back on, okay, that's the strike. That's that. Okay, cool. And then if you're a good official or umpire, like, you're consistent. And they weren't doing that in all these fucking games I was watching. And everybody was telling me I was out of my mind. And then they finally bust this guy, mobbed up ref, fixing games. And then the NBA, it's just one guy.
Right.
Blah, blah, blah. It's like, really? Not even the guys who were on the crew with them? They didn't notice? Maybe they dropped a dime on him. I have no idea.
Well, Lenny Dykstra tells that story about when he was playing for the Mets or whatever. He would get all the skinny on all the umps, and he would find out what they were doing wrong. Gambling, gay,
I love
whatever.
That you just said, get all the skinny.
Get all the skinny. As I said it, I realized I should be killed for this.
Dykstra, get the skinny on the umps.
As it came out, I should be fucking shot. But he would find out all this shit on the umps. He got the skinny, see?
He got the skinny. Yeah.
Well, we blew right over the fact that your two item list of what they were doing wrong was gambling, gay.
Or I should say, which could go hand in hand, actually. But then the things that they didn't want people to know, that they were private about. That he would say to them, he would come up and go, so how was that game last night? Hey, how about that club you went to? Like, he would mention this shit as he was stepping into the batter's box and let them know that he knew private stuff about them, and it expanded his strike zone, and it helped him. And he was
no way.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. He's been pretty open about that since we interviewed him. We didn't get much out of him.
Yeah, I feel like ever since, you remember that story a couple years ago? This is going to seem unrelated at first, but like, there was a story a couple years ago where this high school gave the kids laptops, and they were like loners, and so they had this like software on it to keep the laptops from getting stolen that had tracker software on it, and also had like spy software on it. So they could look at the kids in their bedrooms.
Oh, I remember. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
And they were like spying on the kids. And it was like, I looked that up recently. It was like, it wasn't exactly what you'd assume. It wasn't like one creepy principal that was like making his own porn. Like, it was
It was a circle jerk.
A network.
They really kind of thought that they were just like controlling the school better, and that of course nobody would let us do this, but we're going to be. It seemed that way. I think maybe the IT guy was probably like. it's called. But anyways, the reason that's related is because it's like, it seems like only when people get caught is when you like when you see that, and they always try to pretend like, this weird instance of corruption. But all the people that get caught have something in common. Like, they're weird and dumb. Like, they do something weird.
Yeah.
And then this corruption gets exposed. But it always has these little boundaries around it. It's like, I hate to be this cynical, but it just seems like if corruption is possible anywhere, that I now just assume 100% that it is. If someone's not being policed,
it's only billions of dollars at stake. Yeah, I don't know why that would cause anybody to do anything underhanded.
What would be the motivation?
Yeah, well, it's just
the money.
I just don't see the smoking gun here. Whatever, it's still fuck. It's better than reality television. I mean, I guess it really is reality television, but it's better than the shit my.
You would have to offer
watches.
A lot to get those guys to take. There's
the
just
players.
So much money at stake with those. Those guys make so much money. It's hard to get a guy who makes fucking $5 million a year.
And also then to try to get them to keep their mouths shut and that type of thing. The way in is the officials.
Yep.
Because they're so underpaid. You know.
Are they underpaid? I don't know what they make.
I actually don't either, but I know. I know that it's not like they're underpaid. It's that they make way, way, way less. You're in a business where there's like billions of dollars, hundreds of millions being made. And I think those guys, we got the internet. Can't we look it up? I'm sure somebody put
that. They don't get a lot of endorsement deals. Like,
nobody really knows
Carl
their name.
Johnson, the famous referee for Nike.
You
got to
do it for like 20 years. You know, like Kerry Frazier, I remember in the NHL, he. And Koharski, because the guy says, eat another donut, you fat pigs. So everybody knew who he was. I don't know. Or you write a book or something like that.
It says a major league umpire's starting salary is around $120,000, with the senior umps earning up to $350,000.
But they're only working
right. And there's guys who make that almost a pitch.
That's true, yeah.
Right, you could buy those people out.
Yeah. I don't know about pitch, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, per game.
Per game, they're making that. And they're sitting there, and then they're getting yelled at by these kids. you know, they're in better shape. They're getting laid after the game, and you're just this fat guy going back to a Super 8. Maybe not a Super 8. You know.
No, they fly first class. They probably stay in the best hotel. Like, I think the umps union is pretty strong.
Well, there you go. I'm convinced it's not fixed anymore. You give me $300,000 a year to be like, I'm ball outside.
I get to fly.
Yeah, I get to fly first class. I'm in.
No, because you know what? There was a controversy.
Can I keep the chest protector when I'm done? I'm in.
I love too that you'd adopt an umpire voice. Yeah. Like you wouldn't use your own ball outside.
Ball outside. You gotta enhance your personality.
That's right.
When you do it.
That's right.
One of the guys we got in trouble because they were flying first class and they were actually trading in the first class tickets and taking the difference in financial difference and just pocketing it. And they got in trouble for that. Yeah. They were just flying coach and keeping the difference.
Yeah. That's to me says you're a little underpaid or you got a little meth habit going on. Something's going on. Yeah.
Dan, you don't watch sports at all? Really?
Jesus, look at this woman. My God, who the hell was that?
Was that Melania Trump?
I think it was Melania Trump.
Hey, I got to agree with her dad.
You think if he gets elected, she'll be hanging around more and you'll just, like, she'll be less accessible.
Right? No. I'm saying that he said that she was hot and everybody said it was weird. It's like, yeah, she is.
She's very
hot. Yeah.
You don't watch sports though, Dan?
No, not really. The Brewers went to the World Series in 82 when I was like 10 years old.
You a big Gorman Thomas fan?
Yeah.
Robin Yount.
Vukovic.
Ben Ogilvie.
Oh, my God.
Molitor.
Paul Molitor. That was the guy, yeah.
Yeah, that was my last intersection with baseball.
Cecil Cooper.
And then football, the Packers went to the... Whenever it's mandatory, I'm into sports.
Right.
I was in Milwaukee when the Packers went to the Super Bowl like twice in a row. So
you're like, I kind of have to be aware of what's
going on. That makes it
on,
easy because everybody, if everybody on the block is like watching the same thing and the screen doors on the bars are open and people are just getting high on the sidewalk and like it crosses demographic lines at that point and it's like fun. You just learn the names of the players and
right. I think that's what women need to do with like the Real Housewives. Just have like. More of a festive atmosphere with food and booze and stuff. Then I'll stand in the corner, act like I give a shit. Like, oh, I can't believe she said that to her.
Right.
Like that.
For like their book clubs or something. Yeah, just like make it more of a street party.
Yeah.
Make it seem like it's a neighborhood
gathering. That's one of the big things that I argue with my wife. That's it. Everything else kind of goes smooth.
With the TV?
Is those fucking shows, man.
She watches them all?
Oh, my God. And it's just, dude, it's like I live with them. It's just six women screaming at each other. And then they do like the Sports Center recap with that Andy Cohen. And all he does is he just gets them all stirred up again. I mean, it's a brilliant show.
Yeah.
And it'll just be like, so when so-and-so called you, Baron. And they couldn't, I mean, how did that make you feel? And they start, you know, fanning their eyes and they get going and then they team up with each other. Dude, it's just this screeching.
Who wins those arguments? Does she wind up watching or does she ever go, all right, you're right, too much?
Oh, come on, dude. Who do you think? I end up leaving, storming out.
I was about to ask, do you have another TV somewhere else?
No, now we do, but forever we didn't, but now we do. But women are so social, it's just like, so you're just going to go downstairs and watch TV?
Yeah, they don't want to watch TV without you.
Why can't we watch some together? It's like, all right, well, I want to watch this hockey game. I don't want to do that, and then you end up, I don't know. But she has great taste in movies. We watched this movie the other night. Babadook?
Yeah,
horror
it's great.
Movie. Dude, I had to tap out.
You did?
I totally buy into horror movies. I can't handle it. Like, you know that commercial that was that movie where the lady would you know, the room's all lit up and she shuts the light out and then there's like this person there.
That was Conjuring.
And then she turns on.
It's a new one. It's like In the Dark or something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah. So she turns it back on. It's not there. She shuts it off again. It's there. Turns it back. I was literally watching the commercial home alone. I was just going like, stop turning out the light. And she fucking turns it on again. It's like right in her grill.
Yeah.
And I was like.
It's terrifying.
What's it called?
It's something about In the Dark or something like that.
Is it out now?
I think it's
is it
horror
a new picture?
Movies scare the shit out of me. I totally buy in. You know, those people like, oh, Blair Witch didn't scare me. Scared the fuck out of me. The Ring scared the shit
Ring's
out of me.
The Ring's terrifying. I literally had to sleep with the light on. I remember I saw that in my old apartment. Keith Robinson gave me a fucking bootleg copy of it. I watched The Ring on a giant fucking like 60-inch, like, you know, those giant TVs that would before the flat screen, and I was fucking horrified.
And it's one of those things where the rare time is it was a remake. It was an Asian film. I don't know, Japanese or Chinese.
Ringu,
yeah.
Yeah.
But the remake was better.
Yes, it was.
It was actually better, but they have some. They got one, Old Boy, The Audition. You ever see The Audition?
I did.
No.
Ugh.
Couldn't
I
be any worse than the ones
movies.
I've done.
Yeah.
Jesus. The Grudge was scary too. The Grudge.
Dude, you're hilarious. Down. You watch all those movies. You're into wrestling, dude. You got a van or something in your future. I'm telling you.
Yeah. That's what I do. I spend my time watching weird, like, horror movies and pro wrestling and all that. Yeah.
Do you get, like, after watching all those horror movies, does shit not scare you anymore? Does it take a...
I get scared. Like, I get tense. All those movies tense me out. Like, did you see Eli Roth did a movie called The Green Inferno, which is basically, like, it's a throwback to, like, the 70s cannibal movies. Where there's, like, group of, like...
Cannibal movies? I didn't know that that was a genre.
Oh, yeah. Like, Cannibal Holocaust.
Oh, sure. Don't get me started.
Yeah.
I heard of blaxploitation. I never heard the cannibal...
There was a whole cannibal subgenre.
Rape revenge. Rape revenge.
Oh.
I never heard
cannibal. You spit on your grave?
Yeah, I
saw
that.
Right around the same time.
Where the girl cuts the guy's cock off in the fucking... she got gang raped and she goes back and kills him one by one. She cuts the guy's cock off in a tub. That was probably the worst thing I've ever seen.
What about the 45 minutes of rape in the beginning of the movie?
Well, I can't relate to that as much.
That stuff doesn't happen.
He reacted the way you react when your dick gets cut off. He's like, oh, well, hey. It was this weird shocked moment he had before he realized his cock had been cut off. That's what got to me. I'm like, that's probably what it feels like to get your dick cut off.
To me, that was like an extremely sharp knife. The fact that you would go, oh, and they go, oh, hey. No, I can see that. Oh, ah, ah.
He had a pause. If you watch that, when he gets it, she slices.
I will never watch that again. I saw it once, and that was enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Green Inferno, like this group of like college like activists go into the rainforest to stop the trees from getting cut down and stuff.
Was this financed by Trump? I'm already liking this. Nice.
And they end up like they're there. They're in the rainforest. Their plane goes down, and they get kidnapped by this gang of like cannibal jungle natives.
Jesus.
And they're just sitting there in like a cage made of bamboo while all these natives are just watching them. And I was panicking watching the movie because you're like, how the fuck do you get out of this without
Did they
getting
start it? With like a pudgy one first to be like, this is like Sliders. They have a couple of appetizers.
They take the pudgy one. This is why I was panicking. They took the pudgy one that was like the friend that wanted to be the boyfriend, but you knew was never going to.
The fat cock blocker.
He was. They grabbed him and they cut off his legs first and his arms, and he knew it was all happening, and then they cut his eyes out. And I was like, what the fuck? How do you deal with that?
Well, that's a major artery. How does the man not bleed out? Not to take you outside of the movie here. All right, if you want to read something crazy, read Flags of Our Father. Made that into a movie. Read that.
Yeah, read it or watch the movie.
No, read it.
Believe it or not, I'm a kind of more of a movie guy.
Read it.
Yeah,
read it.
Yeah.
Yes, because if they actually what's in the book, they put it in a movie, it would get NC-17, 18, and 19. Like you wouldn't be able to put it up there.
Really? So you can't cut off like a leg?
Huh? Well, they would hang out. Well, the Japanese soldiers were the only ones that had. They were the only army that had rules about cannibalism, and it was only you couldn't eat another Japanese soldier.
That was the rule.
Yeah, well, they had this weird... They had this thing where... I read the book so long ago. It was basically one time when Britain came in there to try to force them to trade with the rest of the world or take them over, whatever. As they came in, some storm came and wiped out that whole fleet. So then they got this idea that that was some sort of wind god that loved Japan, so there was no way that they could lose. So they didn't really prepare as they stretched across the Pacific, and they didn't have any provisions, and they were on these fucking islands that really didn't have any growth or anything, so they had no food. So
they were eating the people they captured.
Yes. So and it was so fucked up that they only released it like when the guy finally wrote the book, like, 50 years later or something like that, when it was finally declassified or something like that. But they would just tie these guys up and they would just cut meat off their backside while they were alive. And then they would try to keep them alive as long as they could because the vitals had the most protein, and they would just throw them in a pit and they'd be laying there with like, it was just, no, dude, it was like when I was reading, it was like, really, the Japanese back then, they were like the white people of Asia where they thought that they were superior to everybody else. The shit that they did to the Koreans, Chinese, and just all the way through there, like they were.
That's not like doing it to other
they gave
people,
white
that's...
Europeans a run for their money. They really did.
They were actually referred. The Japanese were referred to as honorary whites in an official Pentagon like paperwork. Like before we went into World War II, when we were still thinking about how to play this.
Oh, so they were. Oh, so we gave them a little pat on the head, racist pat.
Well,
on the head.
Like, it was really insidious. It's actually kind of we were the kind of the Han Solo of the planet. It's sort of like when I get patriotic, that's the America I think about. Is like the one that's like cash on the barrel head. Like where I'm a scoundrel. I'm all about the capitalism. And we were watching World War II happen, and we're just sort of like just watching. It's just like and then before and we had a cash. policy. It was like, who needs bullets? Who needs?
Oh, we played it. We played it brilliantly.
And then before we went in, there was like a lot of thinking going on about, you know, all these memos and all these things that you can get, Freedom of Information Act. I know I'm starting to sound like a kooky guy, but this stuff is verifiable. Like, there was like this plan before we went into World War II that lays out the 50-year. As the 50 years after
World
War II.
I would think if you're running a nation, you gotta be beyond 10 days. You gotta be like, all right, we're gonna get into this thing, because they already saw World War I, you know, and the devastation that was. I mean,
and these people,
Ken Burns, the wars, one of the great things I've ever watched.
I wish it was longer though.
you gotta let Dan go. Unfortunately, you're person.
Is it because I started getting geopolitical?
No. Yeah, we're like, we can't have that here. No, I guess you got other stuff going on today.
Do I?
I don't know, but they're saying that you got a hard out. I'm getting text messages.
Well, that's exciting that I have something going on.
Yeah.
We'll take a quick break.
Otherwise, we would have kept you here. But, Dan, what should we notify the people of? Rick and Morty?
The Flags of Our Fathers is coming. I'm doing a revival. And,
just a cannibalism part.
Yeah, Rick and Morty, we should finish that in the next 3 or 4 years or so, the season three. everything else is kind of in development. And Harmon Quest is coming to CISO. How could I be so silly?
Harmon Quest.
Yeah, that's me playing Dungeons & Dragons. Pathfinder is what we're playing, not Dungeons & Dragons, with celebrity guests and stuff. And then it's animated, like the actual action, which is why I was so quiet during the baseball conversation.
You should also check out, I don't know if you're actively promoting it, but there's a great Dan Harmon, Harmontown is the name of the documentary, right?
Yeah.
I think it's on Netflix still, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's right.
I made about myself.
It's good.
in which it turns out I'm a narcissist. That's it. Thanks for having me. You guys are awesome.
Yeah. No worries. Thanks for coming in.